Sorry if I confused you at the beginning, but that's kind of the point of this one. We would be remiss if we didn't talk about the role that miscommunication or problems with communication can play in affecting the physiology of organisms. It's miscommunication time here in our AP Biology videos. The question that we're going to answer in this video is, how does miscommunication affect biological systems? In this video, we're going to talk about how miscommunication works, or more appropriately, how it doesn't work. And then we're going to talk about examples of communication breakdown in disease, but also how we can take advantage of miscommunication or altering communication in medical strategies as well. Hopefully, you will not be confused at the end of this video, but if you are, you know what to do. Let's go back and revisit our communication model so that we can understand what could go wrong with it. In our communication model, we have a sender and a receiver, and the sender communicates a message to the receiver. We've spent our entire unit up to this point talking about different types of senders and receivers and different types of messages. Here in miscommunication, let's pause and let's recognize that things can go wrong at any point in this process. We can have sender problems, we can have message problems, and we can have receiver problems. What we're going to do in this video is give you some examples, though certainly not an exhaustive list, of different types of miscommunication problems at each level in the communication process. We'll start with sender-level miscommunication, and a great example of this is nerve damage. This is an x-ray of a spinal cord break, and you can see it here. This has resulted in paralysis in the individual in which this has occurred. The reason for this is because the spinal cord is the connection point between our peripheral nervous system and our central nervous system. The different nerves from our body enter into our central nervous system in the different vertebrae of our spinal cord. You can see that in this map that connects the different body segments to their respective vertebrae. When you break the spinal cord and you sever the axons of those neurons, all of the nervous control below the region of that break is interrupted. And that is a classic, though absolutely horrible, sender-level miscommunication. The nerve cells can no longer send the necessary signals to the brain, and the brain can no longer send the necessary action potentials to the regions of the body below that break. If the damage to the spinal cord happens high enough, the individual will die because they'll have lost the ability to control things like their ability to breathe, which is obviously a fatal result from this kind of sender-level miscommunication. Moving into the realm of message-level communication, we're going to stay in the nervous system, but we're going to look at the effect of different venom proteins on our nervous system functioning, particularly in respect to our muscles. The connection between our nervous system and our muscles is a special kind of synapse known as the neuromuscular junction. This micrograph shows several different neuromuscular junctions. We see the neuromuscular junctions here in this image, with the nerve cells as the purple bundles and the muscles underneath that large purple blob of the neuromuscular junction. It's a specialized synaptic space connecting the axon terminal of a motor neuron to a particular muscle cell. I've highlighted the neuromuscular junction synapse here in green just so you can get a handle on what we're talking about. Here's a cartoon diagram showing us the same thing. The neurotransmitter that's released into the neuromuscular junction is acetylcholine. The release of acetylcholine by a motor neuron into the neuromuscular junction causes the muscle cell on the other side of the junction to contract. This is the entirety of the interactions between motor neurons and our muscle cells. It's the release of acetylcholine, which is then received by acetylcholine receptors on the surface of the muscle cell, which causes that muscle cell to contract. Of course, you then need the muscle to relax again, and that is accomplished through the action of an enzyme known as acetylcholinesterase. Acetylcholinesterase is also present in the neuromuscular junction, and its job is to take the acetylcholine molecules that are released and break them down so that they no longer cause the muscle cell to contract. The muscle cell will then relax. Venom proteins take advantage of acetylcholinesterase and block it from carrying out its job, so that when acetylcholine is released into the neuromuscular junction, the acetylcholine receptor receives the message, but never has that message removed because acetylcholinesterase can no longer break down the acetylcholine. As a result, the muscle cell remains permanently contracted, and this leads to the muscular paralysis that is a hallmark of envenomation from organisms like poisonous snakes. That paralysis can then interrupt the respiration of the paralyzed prey animal, which leads to its death and gives the snake a healthy meal. Interestingly, this mechanism is also taken advantage of in treatment for diseases like Alzheimer's. The medication Aricept, which is shown here as a blue molecule in the diagram immediately above my head, is used to treat the decrease in acetylcholine that's seen in individuals that are suffering from Alzheimer's. By blocking the action of acetylcholinesterase in those individuals, this allows the diminished acetylcholine that's still present in the synapses of people with Alzheimer's to carry out a more pronounced effect than it would be if acetylcholinesterase was fully active, like it would be if the Aricept molecule was not interfering with its activity. I'm sure it's obvious to you that the Aricept molecule is not going to completely stop the action of acetylcholinesterase. That would not be an effective medication at all. What it's going to do instead is slow down the activity of the acetylcholinesterase so that the lower amount of acetylcholine that's in the space can have a larger effect as a result. Another clear example of message level miscommunication that we see in the nervous system involves a different neurotransmitter, the neurotransmitter serotonin. Serotonin is a neurotransmitter that's released in the brain and is involved in neural pathways that are connected to our emotions and the way that we feel about the events that happen to us. For reasons that aren't particularly well understood yet, changes in the patterns by which serotonin is released into the synapse and then absorbed again by the neurons in the synapse seem to be associated with a variety of mental illnesses, probably most famously bipolar disorder. Classes of drugs known as selective serotonin reuptake inhibitors, the most well-known of which being drugs like Prozac, affect this pattern of serotonin release and reuptake and can have dramatic effects in improving the mental well-being of patients with these mental illnesses, though they are by no means a one-size-fits-all silver bullet for these very complicated mental illnesses. Still, it's a very clear example of how message-level miscommunications can affect the overall physiology of the organism and how these message-level miscommunications can be used in medical approaches to treat the underlying causes of these diseases. Moving now to receiver-level miscommunication, we're going to focus on the role of choleratoxin and other enzymatic toxins and how they fool the cell into allowing them in. The choleratoxin, which is shown directly above me, exists outside of the cell in a two-part structure. The red part is the actual toxin molecule, and the blue portion interacts with receptors on the surface of body cells. The binding of that blue portion of the molecule to the receptor then allows the red toxin molecule into the cell, where it triggers an irregular signal transduction cascade that results in the massive outflux of chloride ions from the cell, which is then followed by a massive outflux of water, and the subsequent pronounced, extensive, and frequently deadly dehydrating diarrhea that is the hallmark of a cholera infection. This approach of using a molecule to bind with a receptor in order to allow a toxin molecule to enter a cell and kill the cell is a common strategy that we see in a variety of organismal toxins, some of which are shown in this diagram here, and all of which are incredibly damaging to the organisms in which these toxins play a role. Of course, this kind of strategy is also used in medicine in order to deliver target drugs to target cells as well. Taking advantage of miscommunication in signal transduction pathways is a frequently used medical approach. We've already seen that in several different instances in this video, but I'll leave you with one other example, which is the use of miscommunication in the menstrual cycle in female birth control. The release of a reproductively capable, mature egg happens each month in mature human females and is triggered by relatively sudden increases in the concentrations of particular hormones in the female endocrine system, specifically follicle-stimulating hormone and luteinizing hormone. Immediately following the release of a mature reproductive follicle from an ovary, the amount of estrogen and progesterone in the body increase, and this is correlated with the maintenance of a thickened uterine lining in anticipation of possible fertilization and subsequent implantation of the egg cell. Hormonal birth control takes advantage of this fact by providing the body with an artificially elevated level of estrogen and progesterone. In so doing, it sends a miscommunication signal to the body that an egg cell has already matured and been released, even though it hasn't. Since there is no actual mature egg cell in the reproductive system when birth control is being taken, there is no ability for fertilization to occur, and as a result, a woman who's on hormonal birth control cannot get pregnant while those hormones are present. The classic 28-day birth control cycle has a week in there of no hormones, and during that week, when a woman is not taking hormonal birth control, a regular menstrual cycle will occur. Upon resuming the hormonal portion of the birth control the next week, the body continues to receive a signal that an egg has been released, and as a result, no egg will be released and no pregnancy can occur. This is just one example of using miscommunication to our advantage in medical approaches. There are many, many others, and they're all very, very cool. Thanks so much for watching our discussion of biological miscommunication. Make sure you can do the following things here at the end. Make sure you can explain how communication can fail in biological systems. Make sure that you can describe miscommunication examples that happen at the level of the sender, the message, and the receiver. And finally, make sure that you can explain how medical approaches can take advantage of cellular communication and cellular miscommunication. If you can do all those things, you're doing great. If not, that's okay too. Take a moment here at the end and write down any questions that you have so that you can get the answers that you need. Thanks again for watching. I really appreciate it. Have a great day.